Ladies and gentlemen, by way of introduction, this is a film about trickery.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? This is Orson Welles. I'm speaking for the Mercury Theater, and what follows is supposed to advertise our first motion picture. Citizen Kane is the title, and we hope it can correctly be called a coming attraction.
Hello, Taylor Dyer.
I'm drunk.
You know, as you watch the film unroll on the screen, the sense of irony seems to me to be terribly present. For the first time ever, the means that Hearst had used to lay bare the lives of others had been used on him.
You don't care about anything except you. You just want to persuade people that you love them so much that they ought to love you back.
Only you want love on your own terms. Something to be played your way according to your rules.
Toast, Jedediah, to love on my terms. Those are the only terms anybody ever knows. So...
It was hard to be friends with Welles in times of pressure. One of the few who managed was an old screenwriter named Herman Mankiewicz, a gambler and a drinker, who had as much contempt for the industry as Welles did. The difference was, Mank knew Hollywood from the inside. He'd even been a guest at San Simeon. Marion liked Mank because he was funny and they drank together.
Willie came to the show, same seat every night, and all the other girls said to watch out. He was too old for me.
He saw her in a chorus line in 1915. Hearst was 52, with his wife pregnant at home.
The thing you got so right in your script was how lonely he'd been as a boy. When my own mother heard he was one of the richest men in America, she said, kick a little higher.
But he still haunted the theaters. Second row, one seat for him, one for his hat. He was familiar to the showgirls, one of the wealthy men who'd give a girl something nice if she favored him with her company. Marion was 18, but a practiced hand at this game. When she lost his first gift, a Tiffany watch, she called Hearst up and got another. She was a gold digger and made no bones about it, but she knew how to make Hearst laugh.
She was incredibly, heartbreakingly beautiful.
How's that?
Charlie, please!
The collision between Hearst and Orson Welles, the battle over Citizen Kane, was in large part a fight over the honor of this woman. But Welles had one problem he couldn't control.
Nobody would give you an argument if you said my father was a self-destructive man.
Maybe Mankiewicz just got careless, or maybe he was showing off. But he gave a copy of the script to one of his old San Simeon pals, Charlie Lederer.
It's her as they imagine her, but it's him, as you knew him.
Damn it, Charlie.
You asked me out here. I was honored to come and read your latest.
Lederer was a friend of my father's, but he was, in addition, which my father knew very well, he was Marion Davies' nephew. And my father gave him a copy of the script. Now, you want to talk self-destructive, I suppose that's a pretty good example. Lederer says he never showed the script to Hearst, but when it came back to my father, it was annotated, clearly by the Hearst lawyers.
He took the script?
Uh-huh.
Will he show it to her?
I don't know.
Do you want him to?
I don't know.
I thought we were very unfair to Marion Davies, because we had somebody very different in the place of Marion Davies, and it seemed to me to be something of a dirty trick, and does still strike me as being something of a dirty trick, what we did to her. And I anticipated the trouble from her for that reason.
They loved her. She was cheery, jolly, generous, and full of humor.
and wit. She was just a glorious gal.
Trouble was that Hearst liked her to be kind of genteel and use her and kind of liked to see her in costume pictures. And that wasn't what she was like. She was actually quite mischievous and had a great sense of humor and really is charming. It's just the stuff that Hearst didn't like to see her do.
Pardon. I don't know what I'm saying.
They knew enough to run it by the lawyers. From that point of view, they weren't at risk. Anyway, if Hearst sued, that would be great. The film would be news everywhere. They'd write in some lines about Marion's drinking and those horrid puzzles. No one in Hollywood could miss the joke. They'd even put in Rosebud, the secret word which, they claimed, was Hearst's pet name for Marion's private parts. They'd drive the old man crazy.
Has degenerated into a racket. The sooner this impudent, intrusive, despotic...
I would have loved to play me 10 years ago.
It was never meant to be you.
For myself, I don't care, Mank. Really, I don't. I love the old guy, Mank. Maybe I didn't always, back when he was my social security. But now, there are things about us together that no one could possibly. Am I persuading you at all?
I hope, if this gets made, you'll forgive me.
And I hope, if it doesn't, you'll forgive me.
There was nothing to hold Marion Davies at San Simeon anymore. She wasn't married and was now, in her own right, wealthy enough to get along with ease. As creditors closed in, she sold jewelry and real estate and gathered $1 million in cash. Then, she turned it all over to Hearst. I started out a gold digger, she said, but I fell in love with him.
But I had to loan him $1 million just to save San Simeon.
You hocked your jewels.
Of course not, just some real estate. He bought me most of it anyway.
Ginger Rogers makes the presentation for Best Actress of 1941. The winner, Joan Fontaine.
Citizen Kane had 9 nominations, and Welles personally was nominated for 4. Best Picture, Best Director, Best Actor, and with Mankiewicz, Best Screenplay.